Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Thanks for choosing to be in this room with no one knows on such a nice day. And listen to our presentation. It's going to take just a quick second to get our slide up. But I'm Ken Ingram. I'm a senior analytics consultant at Starr Associates. I've been using Tableau since about version 7. I was just really impressed when I didn't have to struggle through Excel anymore. And it was just so much easier to do data visualization with Tableau that I just kind of fell in love with the tool. And since then, I have been desktop certified.
Hello, everyone. Christopher McMichael, also a senior analytics consultant with Starr Associates. Been using Tableau since about 2011, so version 6, 7, also desktop certified.
So today, what we're going to do is kind of like a good and better way of presenting data. So we're going to ask a few questions of the data and take a few stabs at it, and then we're going to show you how we built the visualizations that we did, that we ended up with. We're going to be using Atlanta crime data. I figured that here in Atlanta, that might be an interesting topic. Now, this is just data for the city of Atlanta proper, so if you are in a suburb, this does not apply to you. We took a couple of liberties with the data. You downloaded this data set. It's 9 years of data, and what we did was we merged some of the crime types. So burglary comes in residential and non-residential. We just merged the two together. So we just listed those things. So there are 6 categories in the data that you'll see as far as crime types. It also has date and time that the crime occurred. It has longitude and latitude of the crime. It has the neighborhood, the NPU, that sort of thing. That's a good question. There's no indication on the data.
So the questions that we're using to explore the data today, the first question everybody wants to know is, how has the amount of crime in Atlanta changed by neighborhood over the last decade? I think that's pretty straightforward for most. The second question is, given the time of day, which crime is most likely to occur? So are you more likely to be burgled between 7 a.m. or 7 p.m.? Or are you more likely to be robbed between 10 a.m. or 8 p.m.? I was trying to throw that in. Then last but not least, is there a crime pattern based off of time of day and neighborhood? A lot of times on the news you hear about crime waves or crime sprees with a similar type of crime in a neighborhood, so we put that to the test to show what the data says. So the first question, how has the amount of crime in Atlanta changed? So I'm just going to switch to Tableau. So one of the first ways people might typically want to look at this data is just through a standard line chart here. And so let's just walk through what this is showing us. So we have all 10 years at the bottom, and we have the volume of crimes by neighborhood. And so we can see that there was a decrease in downtown. We can see that there was a decrease in Midtown, in the 4th Ward, and in the West End. But every other neighborhood we can't see. So what we call this is essentially a spaghetti chart. It has a lot of data there, but we aren't really able to derive all the information that we want. So alternative way to look at this. What's called a dumbbell chart. And so what this is, just to align everybody, is 2 data points, 2009 and 2018. 2009 is green, 2018 is red, and so those are the ends of the dumbbell. Then there's a line connecting them. And so what that line is the spread and the difference between the two. So to walk through a couple examples really quick, if you look at downtown, One thing that we can also derive from this very quickly is anytime that there is a green dumbbell on the right-hand side, that means that crime went down. If there's a red dumbbell on the right-hand side, that means crime went up. So an example of that would be the Lindbergh section here, where crime was at about 380 in 2009, and then at about 600 in 2018. So there'd be a number of reasons why that happened. But for the sake of today, we are going to focus on that. We're going to focus on how to build a business. So a dumbbell chart is pretty effective in terms of if you just compare two data points. And it's really simple to build. So the first thing that we're going to do is create a bar chart on the report numbers. And so to do that, all we have to do is just right-click our report number and dimensions, pull that over to our columns, drop it, and select count. Next, we break it out by neighborhood. So let's just drag the neighborhood from dimensions and pulling it onto road. And then, what we're going to do is change the marks from bar charts to circles. And so, Tableau does a great job at automatically coming up with a visualization for you. And so you'll see in the marks part section here that it's set on automatic. To change it to the circles, all we do is we just click the drop down, select circles. And now we have one circle that represents all the crime in that area over the last decade. So now what we're going to want to do is add the date, the year. And so to do that, what we're going to do is we're going to take the occurrence date, right-click that, and pull it onto color. And what that does, after we select year, is that changes that one dot to 10 dots. And so the next step would be taking those 10 dots and selecting the two that we want to compare. And so for us, that's going to be 2019 and 2018. So we can just take our occurrence date, right-click it, drop that over to filters, select years, and then select 2009 and 2018 only. So next, so we have the ends of our dumbbell. Now we want to create that bar. So to create that bar, we will create a dual chart on this worksheet. How many people are familiar with creating dual charts on worksheets? Okay, so about half the crowd. So an easy way to do that, just from this bit, is you can use your control button and left click and take that count of report number and just pull it to the right. And so now you have two identical charts on the same worksheet. So next, what we're going to do is we're going to change this chart here, the second chart, to a lookout. And so before we do that, just want to highlight something with the marks chart. So when we created this dual chart, you'll notice that there are three options now for marks chart here. There's a all, there's this one count of report numbers here, and a second count of report numbers here. So the all will control functions on both of that, or both of these words. The first one will control this left one, the second one will control this right one. So we're going to change the right one to a left. So this is actually pretty interesting here. So we created a line. This is the line that we wanted. And the reason why is because Tableau is connecting all of the 2009 data and all of the 2018 data. So what we want to do is just take the line or the color on year here in our marks card for that second chart and change it to the path. Now we'll see we have these nice pretty bars here. So now we have our dumbbell ends and we have our bar. So we just want to connect the two. One of the functionalities in Tableau is dual access. And so what that essentially does is that you can overlay two different charts on one worksheet together. To do that, we're just going to right click on the x-axis on the second chart and click dual access. So now we're almost there. One thing to note with this, and it's kind of a gotcha with making this chart, is if you look at the scale on the bottom, it goes up to 3400, and the scale at the top goes to 3200, so they're not synchronized. So we're going to want to synchronize that. To do that, you can just right click and then synchronize axes. So one other thing to notice with this is you can see that the bar overlaps the dumbbell end. And so it looks more attractive if the dumbbell ends are out in front. So we can fix that as well simply by right clicking and move those marks to the front. Last but not least, if we want to start looking at top neighborhood where there might have been an increase or decrease, we can just use a sort functionality by clicking on the blue fill for neighborhood and clicking sort. So with this, we're going to sort by a particular field, and we want it to be descending, and we want it to be by report number and count. So after we change that, now we have our original things. So that's how you would make a dumbbell chart overall. It's really impactful when you have two data points and you're trying to compare a before and after over a number of different things. So our second question is about trying to understand what's the likelihood of a certain crime to happen during a certain time. So one way that people might typically want to visualize this is by a histogram chart with the colors broken out by crime. And so let's see what insights that this shows us here. So if we look at the 8 o'clock time block, we can see that there are about 13,000 crimes overall. We can see that there was a little bit of aggravated assault, a little bit of auto theft, a little bit of burglary, a little bit of larceny, and a little bit of robbery. So we aren't really able to tell which is more likely to occur without doing some math in our head. So we can let Tableau do some of the heavy lifting and create a dual chart. So this chart here, the top part is a simple histogram, and the bottom chart is a proportion chart, or a percent of total chart. And so looking at that same example, what we can see is that at that 8 o'clock time block, there's a 34% chance that you're gonna be burglarized. There's a 48% chance that that larceny might occur. And you can also see some of the trends in terms of what might happen. So we can see in terms of spreads of time, we can see that between 7 and 8 o'clock, we're very highly likely to be 34%, 35%, in 8 o'clock is very high likelihood. Does anybody think of why that might be?
Work.
Yeah, people are going for work. So, you know, people might be walking around the neighborhood, see people leaving, and then say, okay, I know they're gone from that house. What you can also see in this data is that auto theft is more likely to occur in the evening. So you can see that there's an increase probably about 9 o'clock until about 1, 2 o'clock. And you can see some other interesting tidbits here, but for now we're going to focus on how to build this. So first, we're going to break this into two different charts. And we're going to create a histogram. To do that, we just simply right click and pull our occur time over and select count. And this is just a count of all of the occur times of crimes. then we can leverage Tableau's show me functionality here to select a district. And so let's talk about this for a minute. So Tableau automatically categorizes pins by itself, but you also can adapt those pins based off of your knowledge of your preference. So it creates a new calculated field over here in the dimensions of a current time pin. To edit it, you can right click, select edit. So Tableau originally set this at 56 minutes, which will show the data like this. Now, if you think about her time, this is a number field, but time typically goes from 0 minutes to 59 minutes, it doesn't feel an hour. So we can leverage that knowledge to change that from that 56 to 100, because there's no other data other than 59 minutes as the max. So next, what we're going to want to do is take our occur time, use our control button again, and move that over on our rows again. And so that creates a little chart. So now we have our little charts here. But really what we want to see down here is a percentage of total for that hour block. And so to do that, there's two quick items that we're going to do. The first is we're going to click that second field, go to quick table calculation. And this area allows you to do a number of different calculations in Tableau, which is pretty cool. And select percent of total. So looking at this, all it did was change the values on the y-axis from numerical to percent of total. And it's calculating that percent of total across all of the time. So zero is about 5% of the time between midnight and 5 o'clock. What we really want this to be is a 100% down, so that there's 100% of the time for midnight is in the 1 o'clock. So simply we can just click compute using on our pill and click table down. So what that does here is now we have 100% of the time at midnight to 1 in that one time block, 1 to 2 in that time block. So to finish this off, all we have to do is just drag prime type to a color on our second chart's marks card. And voila, we have our chart. So now we've walked through our first two questions, and now it's going to take us home with the other.
Okay, my question was, are there any patterns in crimes based on data? So I wanted to look at four elements of data. I wanted to look at the day of the week, I wanted to look at the time of day, I wanted to look at the type of crime, and I wanted to look at the number of reports of that crime, right? And so the first stop on that train is like a stacked bar. And so I look at this stacked bar and it's a little busy. I can see some of the things, but it's really difficult for me to pick out and discern pattern from day to day visual without like going into this data and just kind of like hovering and exploring. So the next thing that I did was, let's try something else. Let's do like a weighted line chart. So the thickness in the line over time depicts the number of occurrences of type of crime. So I'm getting a little bit closer in that I can kind of see patterns, but it's difficult for me to compare one day of the week to the other day of the week because it's just hard for the eye to just move throughout this so quickly. So where I landed was a radial bar chart. To familiarize us with what we're looking at, this is, imagine the face of a clock. where this line is mimicking, and time progresses as we go around the circle this way. But instead of 12 hourly marks, there are 24 marks that go around the circle. So this would be noon. So imagine that this is the first part of the day on the right-hand side, and this is the second part of the day. So it's easy for us to see when crime occurs and what type of crime occurs with each of these things. Like, for example, robbery. We can see on Sundays, it's high, you know, from, what is that, 9 o'clock? That's 10 o'clock. That's 9 o'clock until the wee hours of the morning, 3 o'clock. But, you know, it's a little bit different when we look at Wednesday, where the peak time is, you know, it kind of ends at midnight. Maybe they need to go to work at So we can explore this data by neighborhood as well. And I kind of wanted to see, I know we have all neighborhoods selected, but I kind of wanted to take a look and see downtown. Because one of the, when Christopher showed his first visualization, we saw that there was a lot of crime in downtown. I just wanted to see what those patterns look like. And we can see quickly that the pattern is different on a Sunday than it is on a Monday. And we would expect that because there are more people downtown doing business on a Monday than on a Sunday. So those are the types of things that we can explore with a radial bar chart that we weren't going to be able to see using another chart type. And I'll walk you through how I create this. It's very difficult to see this, but if you're on your data source tab, the version that I was using to create this, you have to put your data set in union with itself because you have to have a starting point and an ending point. And thankfully, in 19.3, I think that is not going to be the case. So you're not going to have to duplicate the data set. But I just had to show you this step. So what you would have to do is you would have to drag this data set onto itself, and you can hardly see it here, but it says, you know, drag here to you. The next thing is I'm not going to bore you by entering a whole lot of calculations, but I'm going to show you the calculations that are used here. The first one is path order. So, like I said, we had to have a starting point and an ending point. So I just duplicated the data, and from the first table that I had, the path order is zero. The second one, it's one. It just depicts a start and an end for the line. The radial outer and the radial inner just shows how long this line can go. And I put them in parameters so that I could play around with the size and dimension of it. And I'll show you what that does. And it just narrows the circle in the middle. If I change that to a zero, totally takes the circle away. So that's the inner. And the outer is the same. So I'm going to have to make this 0.5. It just decreases how far those lines can go. So we don't want to do that. So here's where you're gonna wish you paid attention in geology class. So the radial field is one. The radial angle just takes the hour into account and divides the circle up into 24 centimeters. The radial normalized length, it looks at the window and it says, okay, if I have 100 primes at 3 o'clock and I have 10 primes at 4 o'clock, make this 3 o'clock line 10 times as long as the 4 o'clock. And the radial x and the radial y just takes the cosine and the sine in conjunction with the 4 times. Okay, so the first step, after I've entered all of these formulas, is putting the radial y and the radial x on the column of the rows. You see, we don't get much there because we don't have a path. So I drag the path order to path, and I'll show you the formula for path order since I didn't put it in. So if it's from one data source, it makes it a zero. If it's from another data source, so once I add the path order, it knows that it can draw a line from this path order 1 to this path order 0. So the next thing I did was I added this rounded time to the details. So now I have 24 hours, and now I can put lines for each of those 24 segments that we talked about in this pie. And the next step adds a little bit more meaning to it, because what I did was these fills, I did compute using rounded time. So now it knows to look at the time of day and take the number of occurrences from that time of day and adjust the length of the line accordingly.
Quick question.
Sure.
Was your data originally in a 24-hour clock?
It was.
Okay. So if your data actually was using AM, PM, you'd have to do a little more math to it.
As it was, I did have to do some math because it was in military time, and that's why you see rounded time, because I had to make everything fit into an hour. So if it was in the 1 o'clock hour, I had to make it 1 o'clock. If it was in the 2 o'clock hour, I'd make it 2 o'clock. So the next thing I did was I fixed the axis for the x and the y axis, because if we're comparing this across a whole lot of small multiples, we want the axis to be the same size. Because if it's not, if we allow it to automatically size, we're not going to be able to tell one from the other or to discern what's up and down. So the way I do that, I right click on the axis, I turn this to fixed. Do a fixed start at -1 and a fixed end. Okay, the next thing is to create the small multiple is to pull day and prime type onto the columns and rows shelf. It's just a slider and a drop. So then we see the different prime types along this axis and the different days of the week. And so I sorted the prime types because I wanted the prime type with the most occurrences to be at the top and the least to be at the bottom. So I'm going to sort here, descending by the count of the report. And the rest is just some beautification from there. We remove the headers and hide the field labels. And that's a couple of right clicks. So I right click here and hide that. And I right click here and don't show that. And I right click here and don't show this. That's giving me something that's a little bit more visually appealing. Because we don't really care about the negative 1:1, we just really care about the scheme. So the next thing I did was put crime type onto color to make it easier for your eye to go across the screen to see, okay, this is what when I'm comparing crime, one crime type, and this is when I'm just looking at one particular data. And the next thing I did was format to just make those colors pop a little bit more. I put it on a black background here, worksheet black. I took the grid lines out here. And there you have it, your renewal bar chart. And these things can be downloaded. If you want to have access to this site.
You have a question?
No more questions. I'm done.
No, go ahead. So if you're back on your chart,
yeah.
If you wanted, if you added the totals to that,
yes.
So if I were to see, you know, my average across a time for the week, or if I were to see all crimes types for a day, will that automatically include them?
Yes. So you know how you can join data sets? It's the same exact thing, except for when you drag a different source onto the screen, you just drag it on top of itself. And let me see. This is a Twitter, so I need to connect to a data source. That where it says drag table to union.
Yeah, but if I understand you correctly, you had the same data source, you had to do the same thing, like you had to drag the same data source on top of itself.
Right.
You understand
so,
that right?
So let me just show you what that does. Table name field, which is not operating appropriately now, that's saying no, it will have two different table names in it. And just like if you downloaded the same file twice, you know, and how it appends one with a one, that's what will happen when you put those in. And so that's how I use that formula to name, to look at the name of the file. Not appended with a one, I knew that that one was going to be the one that's appended with a one.
Oh, okay. So you needed this for the path order?
I needed it for the
path. That's why you needed it? So normally you wouldn't have to drag the same data source on top of itself.
Right. Okay. But in the next release that's currently in beta, is it still in beta?
Yeah, 19, so you saw what you're talking about. Because that's an important point.
Yeah.
You know, people get lost into this because the first thing you have to do is basically gain the data by doing a union join to create two copies. In 19.2, that goes away. You'll be able to do that path with a new calculation within Tableau, so you don't have to kind of gain the back end. When you said that, I was expecting people to go, woo-hoo!
Yeah.
and to be honest, and I was going to say this after their presentation, the first time I used was at Norfolk Southern, because what are they doing? They're talking about trains going from here to there. That's what they're about, moving trains. And so to understand where the trains are going, they created elaborate visualizations going, it started here and ended here and it cost this much. But to get that path, you had to take a copy of the data source and basically copy it on itself so that you have two copies, and then you can create that 0.0 to 0.1. Well, in 19.2, when Kenneth said that, you know, people, I think it did occur. That's a huge deal. You don't have to do that. There's got to be a special calculation that's going to make that work for you. So that's that is a big woo-hoo moment for Tableau. Can I post that to LinkedIn, y'all? What I'll do is I'll also put this up on our Atlanta Tableau LinkedIn site, so that you just go to the ATUG LinkedIn site, and you'll be able to download the workbook.
Any more questions? Going once? I did.
Just a
personal, you could just as easily do it.
Okay.
Yeah.